Good evening, everyone. I'm Reverend Dr. Kevin Johnson, pastor here of Bloom in the Desert Ministries United Church of Christ here in Palm Springs. I'm happy to welcome you to our Maundy Thursday service here in the remodeled Bloom office space. This is our second service after Ash Wednesday of being here in this setting, and we continue to learn lessons each time we do it. So we just learned one a little bit, and so we're sorry for the tardy start, but and that's a word you probably haven't heard since grade school. But we are here now, and we hope that you're connected with us just fine. I welcome you to this Maundy Thursday service. I'm very grateful for the Bloom Tones Choir under the direction of Ken Forney, as they have prepared for wonderful music to be a part of this service. Very grateful for Reverend Dr. Stephen Wales, who has been the architect and is the primary leader of this service. We're really grateful for him. And we're very grateful for the congregation here in the room and for you as you are coming to us from the online community. And we appreciate your blessing with us. I would just take a moment to remind folks, everyone, set your clock for Sunday morning. Jesus will rise, and so will we. And the Easter sunrise service is at 6 a.m. in the lawn, on the lawn out at the DeMuth Community Center. It's the second time we're able to do that, and we're happy for that. Ken has secured music and so forth. We're looking forward to that, as well as our 10 o'clock celebration service inside at the DeMuth Community Center as well. And we hope that you will join that. These will be in person, as well as online services as well. And we look forward to being with you. So I would not delay any longer and would like to ask and say thank you that I have gotten the hint that I'm supposed to light the candle. So let's do that. And we light a candle on our worship center each time as a symbol of Christ, the light of the world, being in our midst. And we remember always how Jesus said to his disciples and through his disciples to us through the ages that that you are the light of the world. And so this light is with us in this moment. We are with one another as we go from here tonight out into the world, carrying that message and ministry and love wherever we go. Now I would like to welcome Linda Toland, who is going to provide our opening prayer, and we will proceed in our service.
God is with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together.
In this holy day, God, we thank you for Jesus' courage to face the coalition of empire and fearful religious leadership. We thank you for Jesus' commitment to justice, as evidenced by his anti-imperial on Sunday entrance into Jerusalem, knowing it might lead to his arrest and death. We thank you for Bloom in the Desert Ministries, United Church of Christ, and for our life together, as we seek to follow Jesus' path of courage, love, and justice. Tonight we celebrate three of Jesus' Holy Thursday gifts to us that sustain us in our journey. Help us to welcome, receive, and cherish these gifts as they continue to deepen our faith and strengthen our welcome and witness to your love. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please join in singing our first hymn, Jesu, Jesu, fill us with your love, or Jesu, Jesu.
Servants to them. Our first gospel reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8 and 12 through 17. Just before the Passover feast, Jesus knew that the time had come to leave this world, to go to Abba God. Having loved these dear companions, Jesus continued to love them right to the end. It was supper time. The devil, by now, had Judas Iscariot firmly in hand, all set for the betrayal. Jesus knew that Abba God had put him in complete charge of everything, that he came from God and was on his way back to God. So Jesus got up from the supper table, set aside his robe, and put on an apron. Then Jesus poured water into a basin and began to wash the feet of the disciples, drying them with his apron. When he got to Simon Peter, Peter said, "Lord, you wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You don't understand now what I'm doing, but it will be clear enough to you later." Peter persisted, "You're not going to wash my feet, ever." Jesus said, "If I don't wash you, you can't be part of what I'm doing." "Lord," said Peter, "not only my feet then, wash my hands, wash my head." Jesus said, "If you've had a bath in the morning, you only need to your feet washed, and now you're clean from head to toe." "My concern, you understand, is holiness, not hygiene. So now you're clean, but not every one of you." He knew who he was betraying him. That's why he said, "Not every one of you." After he had finished washing their feet, he took his robe, put it back on, and went back to his place at the table. Then Jesus said, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You address me as teacher and Lord, and rightly so. That is what I am. So if I, the teacher, washed your feet, you must now wash each other's feet. I've laid down a pattern for you. What I have done, you do. I'm only pointing out the obvious. A servant is not ranked above the boss. An employee doesn't give orders to the employer. If you understand what I'm telling you, act like it and live a blessed life. Here ends the reading of the gospel.
On Sunday, Jesus had led a demonstration with his entrance into Jerusalem as he enacted the prophecy of Zechariah, of a Messiah king who would come in peace to end all warfare and foreign domination. Behold, your king is coming to you, a just savior is he, humble and riding a donkey. The prophecy goes on to say that he will destroy all the chariots and battle bows, which of course will be a direct threat to Rome. Jesus had held a second demonstration Tuesday, tipping over the scales and the tables and driving the sellers of sacrificial animals out of the temple. The Roman occupation throughout the entire empire did not tolerate dissent or demonstrations for any reason. The Pax Romana really meant that you be compliant and peaceful, or we will wipe you out. Jerusalem's King Herod, the council, and the temple leadership were constantly under Roman pressure, and the institutions of the temple and the council and the monarchy were permitted to function only so long as they guaranteed that the temple police and the palace police would squelch all religious and political demonstrations. Jesus' demonstrations were a threat to the status quo. They still are. So the authorities looking for him, and now Jesus has discovered Judas was involved in a plot to turn him over to those authorities. All four Gospels agree that Jesus knows in his gut that the Passover celebration will be his last and the last night of his life, the last gathering with his mother, his disciples, and his friends. What would it be like to know that it's your last supper, your last meeting with your family of choice? What might you be thinking about? What might you be thinking about Judas? What might your anxiety level be? And might the natural reaction to make this all about me? But Jesus instead makes it to be about those people that he's leaving behind and those who will come after them, including us. While the Passover is a ritual meal celebrating Israel's freedom from the bondage of slavery in Egypt, it was always celebrated not at the temple or not in the synagogue, but at home or in some large space where you could gather with your family and friends. In all gatherings throughout the Mediterranean, everyone knew and expected that the lowest servant in the household would be the one that would wash the feet of the guests from the dust of the road as they arrived. And Jesus, the host of the dinner and the rabbi of this assembly, shocked everyone as he disrobed and put on the apron-like towel and began washing the feet of the guests, of his disciples. For a servant to do this was so ordinary a thing that one would continue conversation as if they weren't there. Servants were kind of thought of as invisible. But when the servant's role is being performed by the host, the rabbi, stripped down and on the floor at your feet, washing your feet, the intimacy and the role reversal are shocking. Most of the disciples didn't know what to say, and Peter blurted out as usual, Lord, you'll not wash my feet. It should be me washing yours. Jesus says, unless you allow me to serve you, you don't have any part in my way of life. Peter blurts out, well, if one is good, two is better. Wash my hands. Wash me all over. And Jesus said, it's not about hygiene, Peter. It's about holiness. It's the holiness of service. The holiness of serving another person. The holiness of allowing someone to serve you. Jesus kept speaking about the least will be the greatest. The last shall be first. And nobody was getting it. But Jesus disrobed on the floor, washing their feet, is the picture that was worth 1,000 words. He says, I am the teacher and I've done this for you as an example. The path of mutual service blesses everyone in a way that the path of hierarchy can never do. Tonight, Linda Toland, our moderator of this congregation, washed your hands as you came into the service. The moderator in some churches is called the president, and the president washing the hands. And the word minister means servant, coming from the Latin. And the word pastor means the shepherd who cares for the flock. It's all in the Christian life, it's all about service. And that comes from our Jewish tradition in the same way. We are here, not only here in this place, but here on this earth, to serve one another, including those who are called to lead, are called to serve one another. The gift Jesus gives to us as he's leaving is the gift of one another. In the foot washing, the gift of intimate equality. We belong to one another. As Jesus' followers, we are not above one another, none of us. We are side by side to serve one another, especially at the highest point of need. St. Paul will call us the body of Christ. Christ's hands and feet and arms and legs and ears and eyes, and one hand washes the other. And no part of the body can do without the other. We belong to one another in mutual service. In mutual service. Let us sing together regarding the gift of a new commandment. That will be on the next page. Jesus, a new commandment has given us.
Jesus, a new commandment has given.
Gospel reading be by the Reverend Tricia Walton.
A new command from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 33 to 35, and chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. And Jesus said, "Children, I am with you for only a short time longer. You are going to look high and low for me, but just as I told the Jewish leaders, I'm telling you, where I go, you are not able to come. Let me give you a new command. love one another. In the same way I loved you, you love one another. This is how everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, when they see the love you have for each other. I've loved you the way Abba God has loved me. Make yourselves at home in my love. If you keep my commands, you'll remain intimately at home in my love. That's what I've done. Kept Abba God's commands and made myself at home in God's love. I've told you these things for a purpose, that my joy might be your joy, and your joy wholly mature. This is my command. Love one another the way I loved you. This is the very best way to love. Put your life online for your friends. You are my friends when you do the things I command you. I'm no longer calling you servants, because servants don't understand what their employer is thinking and planning. No, I've named you friends, because I've let you in on everything I've heard about Abba God. You didn't choose me. Remember, I chose you and put you in the world to bear fruit, fruit that won't spoil. As fruit bearers, whatever you ask of Abba God in relation to me, God gives you. But remember the root command: love one another. Love one another. So ends the reading of the gospel.
So Maundy Thursday is named after this scripture. In Old English, Maundy meant a commandment. Our word mandate derives from Maundy. A commandment isn't a suggestion. It's a command. And another time, Jesus borrows from the Torah and commands us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Yet another, Jesus makes a more challenging and more difficult command, that we are to love our enemies. But this one about loving the people with whom we share our faith life, loving the people whose feet we are called to wash, loving our fellow church members, be it a church, a synagogue, a mosque, a gathering of Sikhs or Buddhists, religion is such a personal thing and such a passionate thing that we each can come to have specific, very specific, and may I say very, very specific ways that I think things ought to go in church. You know where this is going? Yeah. And you ought to think the way I think. You ought to go the way I say to go. And things ought to go the way I think they ought to go. St. Irenaeus said, the church is like Noah's Ark. If it weren't for the storms on the outside, you'd never be able to tolerate the smells on the inside. Jesus has seen such quarreling among his disciples. And even between different sects within his Jewish community. And we have certainly seen that in our lives and between various religious groups. Jesus did not say in this that we have to agree on everything. I don't have to like everybody in the church, he didn't even say that, but I am required by Jesus to love everybody. I am required to love you, and you, as sometimes as difficult as I can be, are required to love me. To will the best for you. When I say I love you, I'm willing the very best for you, no matter what. I'm going to act on your best, on your behalf in the best way I can, no matter what, even when I disagree with you. It's very much related to that gift of mutual service that we talked about. Requirement that we must love one another is actually a gift. Knowing that Christ is offended when I don't act lovingly toward my siblings in Christ is a good thing for me to know. Because sometimes I can be frazzled and I have only one nerve left and you're on it. You know? Church is like that. It can be like that. You know, we're talking about things that are at the core of our being. Or things that are we're justice people have the same issues about the way we think things ought to go. And I've heard some rumors that sometimes I'm on your last nerve. We know what Jesus wants from us. Love our neighbors as we love ourselves, love our enemies, and yes, love our friends in the church. Love those people at the church. Jesus gave us this gift because he says that communities that love each other are rare. That when people see us loving one another with all our faults, then all our differences, that they will know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Jesus, the Jewish rabbi, says, love one another as I have loved you, and greater love has no one than this. Then you lay down your life for your friends. The Message translation has it, this is the very best way to love. Put your life on the line for your friends. I think of another Jewish leader, President Zelensky of Ukraine, who was offered safe passage out of the country at the time of the Russian invasion. And he refused. And he chose instead to love his people by being there, by putting his life on the line next to them. Jesus calls us and gives us this gift of being next to each other and loving each other. No matter what. No matter what.
Amen.
One Lord of all, one. Our third reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 7 through 10 and 13 through 26b. The day of unleavened bread came, the day the Passover lamb was to be butchered. Jesus sent Peter and John off, saying, "Go prepare the Passover for us so that we can eat it together." They said, "Where do you want us to do this?" He said, "Keep your eyes open. As you enter the city, a man carrying a water jug will meet you. Follow him home. Then speak with the owner of the house. The teacher wants you to know, where is the guest room where we can eat the Passover meal with my disciples? He will show you a spacious second-story room, swept and ready. Prepare the meal there." They left, found everything just as he told them, and prepared the Passover meal. When it was time, he sat down, all the disciples with him, and said, "You've no idea how much I've looked forward to eating this Passover meal with you before I enter my time of suffering." "It's the last one I'll eat until we eat it together in the kingdom of God." Taking the cup, he blessed it and then said, "Take this and pass it among you. As for me, I'll not drink wine again until the reign of the kingdom of God arrives." Taking bread, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Eat it in my memory." He did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, written in my blood, blood poured out for you. Do you realize that the hand of the one who is betraying me is at this moment on the table? It's true that the chosen one is going down a path already marked out. No surprises there. But for the one who betrays, turns traitor to the chosen one, this is doomsday." They immediately became suspicious of each other and began quizzing one another, wondering who might be about to do this. And within minutes, they were bickering over which of them would end up the greatest. But Jesus intervened. "Kings like to throw their weight around, and people in authority like to give themselves fancy titles. It's not going to be that way with you. Let the senior among you become like the junior. Let the leader act the part of the servant." Here ends the reading of the gospel.
Thank you. That was Ray Stimson, who's our worship coordinator. The gift of Holy Communion happened in the context of the Passover celebration. Passover was to be celebrated with one's family, and Jesus' mother was with him, and his choice was his disciples, and family of choice was his disciples, the men and women were who were her, his friends. And since they're in Jerusalem, where they had, where he has no steady home, Jesus sends Peter and John into town saying, "Look for a man carrying a water jug and follow him." And you're thinking, well, that's not very specific. Well, in the Middle East, carrying a water jug was woman's work. And a man carrying a water jug in Jerusalem at Passover would stand out like a drag queen who decided to wear a gown and a tiara into a Southern Baptist church on Mother's Day. And Jesus says, follow that one home. And when you get there, says Jesus, speak to the man of the house. Not the man with the jug. And he will show you the spacious room upstairs. Luke, who introduces women into leadership. Luke, who has the black Ethiopian eunuch, who has Gentiles in leadership, who has the Roman centurion, the hero, who has lepers and every other kind of person imaginable, seems to be telling us that the first communion service gift, which was an add-on course to the Passover meal, and that while some of his family members may have been there, his disciples and other family members of choice were there, that that meal may very well have taken place in the home of a same-gender couple. Whether you are as ordinary as apple pie and unleavened bread, or as exotic as you can be, Jesus says there's a place at the table for everyone born. There is a place at the table for everyone born. So whoever you are, and wherever you are on your journey of faith, you are welcome here. The gift of communion is intended for you whenever you choose to receive it. Long before our ancestor cavemen and women knew anything about cave painting, they knew that the best way to build relationships was by sharing a meal with the people in the cave next door, or the cave across the mountain or across the brook. In Luke's gospel, if Jesus isn't at table with the right people, he's at table with the wrong people. If he isn't feeding 4,000 or 5,000 people, he's telling a story or a parable about a banquet or a heavenly feast. The Holy Communion is given as an addition to the Passover meal because Jesus was giving a gift to his disciples to be in touch with them after he was gone, a way to be with him. Jesus knows he's going to die. If the Sunday demonstration didn't do it, Tuesday's tipping over the tables in the temple and chasing the sacrificial sales people certainly pushed things over the edge. The Gospels indicate early on that both Roman and temple authorities are not happy with Jesus. When Jesus says, under the signs of bread and cup, this is my body given for you, my body is a Hebrew metaphor. This is myself. This is my personality. This is my life's work under this sign given for you. Every time you gather to break bread, remember me. I am there with you. This cup is a new covenant written in my blood. Blood in the Hebrew Bible is the life force. One's life force. I poured out my life into this way of living and loving for God. Every time you gather, drink the fruit of the vine, remember me, and I am there with you. Jesus is saying something very similar to Martin Luther King's, I may not get there with you, but I've been to the mountaintop. I've seen the promised land. And like Moses, who had led the people so far, but who died before receiving the promise. I've been so moved by the gift of Holy Communion. The work of a Belgian theologian, Edward Skillebeck, proposed this idea for 21st century Christian folk to think about the communion. It's called transsignification. It's much more exciting than that boring name, I promise you. But he says, think of going into a chocolate shop near Valentine's Day and choosing the richest, the best chocolates, the best ones on the shelf to present to your sweetheart. On the shelf, it's an expensive concoction of cocoa beans and sugar. But in the hands of the presenter, and to the presentee, on Valentine's Day, in a heart-shaped box, it is no longer merely cocoa beans and sugar. It's me that I'm giving you. It's my heart, my love. Or in the jewelry store, he suggests that the diamonds are under glass, they're expensive stones, compressed carbon, cut to reflect light. But when a man or a woman buys that rock and drops to the knees before their beloved, holding out that object in that very vulnerable position, and asking that person to marry and be the love until death parts us, it is no longer just an expensive rock. For that person in that most vulnerable kneeling position, it is me offering my love, my heart, my hope, my life. Will you accept me? And will you give me your life in return? On the night before Jesus died, it was Jesus' last thought to offer himself and his love to you and me under the sign of bread and cup. The most ordinary food, just as the chocolate in the heart-shaped box is no longer merely cocoa beans and sugar and diamonds are no longer merely compressed carbon, to us who love him, the bread and the cup are no longer merely food, but the presence of the one who gave it to us, that in all our eating and drinking together, we may know with certainty that he has never left us and never will. We'll celebrate the Holy Communion.
As we join together in our time of communion, we understand this as a time of being a gift from God as a part of the grace that comes into our lives. We also know that there are times when we give gifts. And so we have provided that if in this evening on Maundy Thursday, you would want to make some kind of offering of support for the congregation, for the mission, vision, values of this congregation. There is an envelope in your bulletin, as well as we have on the table when you came in an offering basket that you may use for that. So let us continue in this time of giving as we participate in the great Thanksgiving. God is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
As we gather, we remember we are earthlings and we are fallible, and we forget things. And we are one with everything, living and non-living on this planet, connected, interrelated, interdependent.
The earth and all that is in it is witness to the spirit of life. We celebrate our oneness with the plants and the animals which surround us.
In this season of change, once again, we are reminded when spring comes that in the Northern Hemisphere, new possibilities can rise from our failures or disappointments or what has come to an end. For cool nights and sunny days, for science and vaccines, and for joy of gathering together again.
We give thanks for all these things.
Especially tonight, we give thanks for Jesus the Christ, gatherer of friends and followers, teller of stories, washer of feet, breaker of bread, pourer of the cup, connector of persons in his life, wisdom, stories, and social vision. We recall the new commandment words he spoke to call forth in us love, care, and respect for one another.
And we believe the same Spirit of God that came to visibility in Jesus yearns for visible expression in us.
Galaxies and suns and stars and planets continue to share in our existence.
We stand in wonder and awe.
Thus we cannot help but join in the unending song of the cosmos.
Santo, 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 Mecores onde dora, Mecores onde sabere sir, Santo eres Deus. Holy, 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 my heart adores you.
That after sharing the feast of the Passover, which is the celebration of the liberation of God's people, just prior to his arrest, Jesus used two cups. Jesus took the Elijah cup, traditionally reserved for the Holy One to come. Instead of Jesus passed the cup of justice onto them, as it has now been passed to us. Remembering God's power, Jesus took bread, and after he had given thanks and blessed it, he broke it, saying, "This is my work and my life for you and with you. Take it, all of you, and do this remembering me." And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Drink of it, all of you, and do this remembering me." Each time that we break bread together, we participate in the body of the risen Christ. For we are the body of the risen Christ. And each time we share this cup, we participate in the new community, for we are God's hope of the new community. For this, we ask your blessing. Pour out your spirit on us and on these gifts of grain and grape, both at this table and at the tables of those participating with us in their homes, that in this sharing, we may recognize the risen Christ in this meal, in one another, and in all creation. This offering of praise and thanksgiving is an offering of us to you. Hasten the day when the prophet's dreams come to pass, when justice rolls down like waters,
and nations no longer threaten each other, neither shall they learn war anymore. This we pray in the name of Jesus and in the prayer he taught us, saying,
Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God, presented both here and in your homes or wherever you are. You need not be a member of this congregation or any household of faith to join us at this table. For we believe that Christ is the host, Christ sets the table, and Christ welcomes all. Let us come, for God's table is ready, the bread of heaven, the cup of salvation, for everyone is born in the place at the table.
We can come forward as you wish for Holy Communion. We have both the cups that have been pre-sealed that we have been using. We also have the broken bread, which you may dip into the cup. And there is also, we have some people who are on gluten-free diets, and so the wafers are gluten-free. Okay. So you may come forward and as you wish. Heaven, the cup of salvation. Bread of heaven,
heaven, a cup of blessing. The bread of heaven, a cup of blessing. Please join me in the prayer after communion. Let us pray. Eternal God, source of all life, your days are without end and your mercies without number. We thank you for the gifts of Maundy Thursday, and especially for feeding us at your table, especially with bread, cup, and Christ's presence. We pray for all those in need this night, especially. And you may name any people at this time that you are concerned for.
Stuart Martin.
People of Ukraine. People of Russia. We pray for all those living with or affected by the coronavirus as we remember globally the millions who have died. We are grateful for the vaccines and for the hope and promise they have brought for new opportunities for us, including the opportunity again to gather for worship and friendship. God, of those in this room and of those participating online, of people around the world, we pray for the people of Ukraine and for peace. God, your wisdom shines in all your works. Your glory is shown in all goodness to all people. Your grace and truth are revealed in all creation. We thank you for your goodness and love shown to us in the life and death of Jesus. Holy One, as we are challenged by Jesus' love for and belief in us, and as we are shocked by his death, come Sunday, may we equally be stunned by his resurrection and by your persistence in giving new life to the world around and to us. Amen. Our hymn is Day Is Done.
May we see in God's possession.
May God, who formed us from the dust of stars and earth, bless and keep you in this life and the next. May Jesus Christ, the living Word of God, our sibling, Savior, and friend, walk with you as you continue his work of justice and peace all your days. May the Holy Spirit, the wisdom of God, empower, lead, and guide you in the path of love for God, neighbor, and self.
Amen. And now we ask our question of our tradition. What does God need from us, from you?
Simply to do justice, to love kindness, and walk humbly with our God.
My dear friends in faith, will you go from here and be the people of God in Christ's name?
We will.
Amen. Let us offer to one another safely and carefully signs of grace and peace, and go in peace. Amen.
Did you say thank you? I could definitely take